Now, you want the story about Grampy, right? I mean, Danny.
Mm-hmm. I have a few questions.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah.
We'll wait for...
Sure.
You know what I did Sunday? I was in a writing mood.
Mm-hmm.
And I got writing about, in regards to my Danny.
Mm-hmm.
And so, of course, your dad lived it too.
Yeah.
Did we all.
Were those the notes that you gave my dad?
Yeah,
or?
But these are...
More.
Right.
Okay.
But this is, and I'd like you to show these to your dad too.
Mm-hmm.
What I wrote, and you could make a copy for yourself or your dad. Or,
okay.
But I'd like your dad to have a copy.
Sure, yeah.
So Sunday afternoon, I just sat down, and you're probably going to say, oh my God. I started to read, to write rather. And I got.
That's great. Yeah,
writing.
Very good.
And I got all this for you about Dan.
Hi. How are you doing, God? Dude, you're getting taller all the time. Have you kept getting taller, or are you?
I don't know. Yeah, I'm kind of
no, you do.
There.
Look, you do look taller, as a matter of fact.
Thank you. Saying,
it's the good food at school, he said.
Yeah.
Must make him want to grow.
Oh.
Yeah. You all right, honey?
I'm okay.
Okay, so.
Yeah.
You can
right.
What you said to me. And he's going to film it, honey, so we don't mind.
Okay.
You don't mind, do you?
No.
Just, yeah.
I think this will work fine. Yeah. Perfect. Okay. So I'm taking a class on storytelling, and I have to. This is our final project where we have to talk about. A memory from our childhood.
Mm-hmm.
So mine is visiting Uncle Danny's grave.
Right.
And then I have to find out what's real about it and find out more about the story.
Mm-hmm.
So this is my first interview.
Yeah.
Right. Well, I think that you've got a regular document there.
Yeah.
Well, like I was saying to Ben Sunday afternoon, I just started writing from what I know. And what we went through as a family. You know?
Mm-hmm.
But, and I have a picture that I'll let you see. This is Danny. I think it was taken in, well, he passed away in August, probably just before he died. This is on his ship, the USS Antietam.
Yep.
Yep. There's Danny.
When did you get the picture?
Before he died.
Yeah.
Yeah. He sent it to us. Yeah. And this is him, about 12, I think.
Mm-hmm. This picture's familiar.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And this is, these are pictures when your dad came home. They gave him permission to come home. He was in the Army at the time. Reserves. I think he was in Alabama. But you can check with him to be sure. And when Danny passed away, they gave him permission to come home. And these are pictures of your father after everything was said and done, the funeral and your dad leaving to go back to the Army in Alabama. And I thought you'd briefly like to see those.
Yeah, I'll take a picture of these two before I go, but...
That's my saying goodbye to him. He had to go back. Because they gave him permission, I think, a week or two home. And these are pictures I'm going to give to your father of our family. Of course, they go way back.
Okay.
He might. I know I'd like them to have them. And you can see them too when you get home. And this is our latest picture of Danny. I think it was taken a couple more months before he died at his girlfriend's house You love the Grateful Dead, the band group?
Yeah.
He went to every concert, I swear. And there he is at his girlfriend's house. But that's the real Danny that you're looking at there. He was full of it. Yeah, it was great. Yeah, it was great. And very brilliant, smart boy.
Mm-hmm.
And do you want me to read this to you?
I can ask you a few, like, questions.
Oh, sure.
Okay. So, the first one is, like, what do you think about this film being made?
We're both fine with it.
Yes.
Yeah, your grandfather and I are fine with it.
And,
it's hard to talk about, but
yeah,
we get through it.
Absolutely.
Yeah, because even to this day, it's difficult. Never gets easy.
Do you have any certain memories of Uncle Danny or, anything about at home or at school, anything that comes to mind?
Well, I'll tell you something, and I don't know if your grandmother's forgotten this, but it was such a crushing blow, you know, that your mom went into hiding for about 5 weeks up north in northern New Hampshire. And I was just bumbling along, working, etc. But boy, the steam had gone right out of my sails. And that may be in her story, but ultimately, I just had lost so much energy that I decided to retire. And that was in June of 1992. And when I retired, we moved the whole family up to northern New Hampshire. While we were up there, maybe 2 or 3 years after we had moved up there, I had the most powerful dream. It's right in my head. Danny was a very tall boy. Man. And at one time he had a car which was made a lot of noise, etc., and blum blum blum, etc.
He was 6'4".
And so I had this dream about 2 or 3 years after we moved up there
to Pittsburgh.
In the dream I hear the blum 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 of the car. This is all a dream. I get up and I go to the door, and through the door comes Danny. Hmm. What a dream.
Yeah. After the funeral.
And he says, yeah, I love you.
For us even today.
Mm.
And I said, I love you too.
Yeah.
And we hugged each other.
Yeah.
And that was the end of the dream.
Yeah.
But what a dream.
Yeah, you told me, huh? I've dreamt of you too. Well, after the funeral in August of 1990, I just had to get away from Wakefield. So we always rented up in Pittsburgh, New Hampshire for years and years. And the children were older. I could go up there. And Grampy had to work, of course, so I stayed up there and I needed that. So I stayed about 6 weeks, wasn't it?
Yeah, it's about 6 weeks.
Before I could even face to come back to the house in Wakefield.
Number 9 in northern New Hampshire.
And see him everywhere in my house on Park Road in Wakefield. Right. You saw him everywhere, but he was a great boy and a great child, and he's very smart, very smart. And he had many, many friends, and he was full of it too.
He hoped to become an architect, and I don't know if that's in your story, honey.
Yeah, well, after he got out of high school, He sort of tried tried different things for a year after he got out of high school, and he got a couple of jobs. And the last job he had when he got out of high school, so I don't like it. I don't like it. Because I saw him walking home one day around lunchtime, and I said, Danny, I said, what are you doing here to work? He said, oh, Ma, I just left. I didn't like it. He says, it's not for me. And so a year from graduating, in June of 88, he joined the Navy in June of 89. And then he was in the Navy for 14 months until he was killed in August of 1990. Yeah. But he had a great personality and loved to talk. Oh my goodness, loved to talk. He could talk a leg off a table. And many, many friends, didn't he?
Yes, he did. Yeah. Many.
And everybody loved him. But he, I don't know how he ever decided on the Navy. But all of a sudden, I never knew what he was about. And he came home one day, and he came into the kitchen, and he says, Ma? I says, yeah, call me Ma. I said, okay, what's up? And he says, I joined the U.S. Navy. I said, you what? He said, yeah, I thought I'd give it a try. Oh, I said.
Now, remember, her father was in the Navy during the Second World War.
No, first. The First World War. My dad was in the Navy. During the First World War.
It couldn't have been the first, honey.
Honey, it was. 1918.
It was.
Yes,
yeah,
it was.
Yeah, that's right, too.
And he joined up when he was 17, and he lied. He told the Navy people he was 18. Well, my grandmother, his mother, found out. She went right to the Navy place and dragged him home. Dragged him back home. He said, Alfred, that was his name. You're not joining. Well, my goodness, he wasn't happy. The next year he turned 18, went back in and joined the Navy. And that was the start of World War I. And so he was in the Navy for 3 years on a destroyer, like Danny was. And one day, out in the middle of the ocean, off the coast of Germany or somewhere there, another ship was struck and went down, and all these Navy sailors were in the water. And so he and his fellow sailors were responsible for rescuing these other men from the ocean. And so my father's helping pulling them out of the ocean, these men. And all of a sudden he reaches down to bring this sailor on board. And the sailor looked at my father, and he said, this granted off the coast of Germany, hi Al, how you doing? Oh my God, didn't he pull out of the ocean a childhood friend?
Wow.
Hi Al, how you doing? My father never forgot it. He told me that story so many times, he never forgot. Imagine that though, what do you think of those odds?
Let's concentrate.
I know, but isn't that credible?
Yes.
Yeah, and so that was my father's experience. And so Dan knew that my dad went in the service and the Navy, and so that's how we joined up. Yeah. And so when he joined up, he went to train in, what do you call that first part of the training, boot camp or something?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So he went to train in Orlando, Florida. So he trained there for 3 months till August, and he did very well, very well. And I think he was at the top, well, I know he was at the top of the class when he graduated from there. And that was in 89 of August. Then from there, he went out to California for training to be an electrician. So he was out there from August to April of till April of 1990, and he came home for a period of 3 weeks. And then he knew after he was home in April of 19, when he went back, he was going to get his ship in California. And his ship was called the USS Antietam. Mm-hmm. And the name was from a famous ship that did battle in the Civil War. So he came home and he was so happy because he says, finally, he says, we're going to get out on the ship. He's all excited. And before he left, he made the rounds, saw all his friends. And then your dad, in April of 1990, when Dan came home, was in a play called The Brigadoon. And, of course, your father wanted Danny to go and us to go. But then he came out to me in the kitchen a couple of days before, and he says, Ma, he says, is what Danny? He says, do you think Andy would be okay if I didn't go see USS, if I didn't go to see Brigadoon? He says, because, you know, I only have a couple more days left. He says, and I'd like to see all the rest of my friends one more time. I says, oh, Andy will be fine with that. He won't mind. Well, he didn't go. And then at the end of April, he left. That morning I was working at Reading Layton, Reading, Massachusetts. And I said goodbye to him that morning, but he stopped by with Auntie Elaine. Auntie Elaine was driving him into Logan. And he said, Ma, he said, I just wanted to say goodbye one more time. I said, oh, great, Danny. And I hugged him and I said, Danny, you take care of yourself. You better take care of yourself. I love you. And he got in the car and I watched him go down the street with Elaine to Logan Airport. And that was the last day I ever saw him alive. And then he got on his ship. His ship left. He got to California. And he got on the ship. And everything he wrote, and everything was going well, and he was doing well. He was. And that was in June. They sailed out. And I used to kid with him. He said, before he left, he says, oh, Ma, you know, he said, when I get our ship, he says, we're going to Hawaii, Hawaii, Korea, Singapore, Hong Kong. I says, wow, that sounds like tough duty. I said, that sounds like you're going to have it made. See all these beautiful places. Shema, doesn't it? He's all excited. Well, when the ship sailed, the first stop was Hawaii. And they all got off the ship to enjoy some land time in the fireworks July 4th. And he wrote and told me how beautiful it was. And that was the last time his feet touched the earth. When he left Hawaii, that was the last time. And he never got to all those wonderful places that he was going to go, wasn't meant to be. And then my husband, Grampy, and I, in August, we went up to Pittsburgh again to vacation. But before we did, the end of July, August 2nd, I'll get it straight, came on the news that Saddam Hussein, the president of Iraq at the time, we were informed that he invaded Kuwait. And I said to Grandpa, I said, oh, I had an awful feeling. I said, oh, I said, that's terrible. I said, he invaded Kuwait, there's going to be trouble. And so Grimpy and I, after that, around a couple of weeks later, we went back to Pittsburgh and we rented. And the woman that owned the cabins up in Pittsburgh, she knocked on the cabin door and she came in and she says, "Oh, did you hear the news?" I said, "What news?" And she said, "Saddam Hussein is causing a lot of trouble in Kuwait. And the ship, the Antietam, that Danny was on, is sailing to do whatever they could do to protect our country." And he was in harm's way. And I said to your grandfather, I said, we were both sick because we said, "Oh my God, our Danny's in harm's way." It wasn't good. So we were just worried and concerned, like Grumpy says, very, very much. And so after that, we heard a week later that it was August 21st, came a knock on the door at 8:30 in the evening. Grimpy happened to work at night at the time, another job. And it was 8:30, and I went to the front door. The only ones that were home were Uncle Leith and Aunt Alicia. They were upstairs. So I went to the door. And when I went to the door, it's a parent's worst nightmare. There stood two naval officers. And they said, "Mrs. Jones," I said, "Yes. May we come in?" I said, I can't even explain it to this day. I think I just went into instant shock. Like, no. Denial. See, I can't even explain it to this day, my actions. So I said, "Come in." And I brought them out into the kitchen because it was just straight ahead. And I think Uncle Leith heard people, as did Alicia. And they came down. No, Leithy came down. Oh, no, how was it? Yeah, he did come down. He came running down the stairs, and he said, "Ma, what's up?" And then he looked, and he saw what I saw, the two naval men. One was a naval officer that visits these people that have lost loved ones, and the other gentleman was a United States Navy chaplain. So when Leithy came down, he stood very close to me at the kitchen chair, and the two men were in front of me in the kitchen, and they just stood there, and he said, "Mrs. Jones, is your husband home?" And I said, "No," I said, "he's working." And he said, "Would you want to get on the phone and call him to come home?" This is before I heard anything. And I said, "No," I said, "no, he's very busy." I said, "No, it's all right if he's not here." I think back in my mind, I didn't want him here to hear what I was going to hear, but I didn't know what I was going to hear. Then all of a sudden, not the chaplain, but the other naval officer brought out a letter, and he started to read. And he said, "This letter is from the captain of the USS Antietam." And at the same time, nothing else was spoken until this time. And he started to read the letter that I've read to myself in my mind for years and years and years. It's ingrained and started out by saying, "Dear Mr. and Mrs. Jones, we regret to inform you that today, August 21st, at 2:30 p.m., but they gave me naval time in the afternoon, on board the USS Antietam, your son, Daniel M. Jones, was electrocuted, and it was an accident. We deeply regret his passing and blah, blah. Never forget it. Well, all of a sudden, everything just went crazy. And Leith's hugging on to me as tight as possible, and it was devastating. And Alicia came down, started screaming, Danny, not Danny. It was a nightmare of a night. And they offered to stay longer, and I said, no. I said, we'll be all right. I said, I have a big family. We'll be all right. And of course, they said, anything you can do to help, we will do. But on that fateful day, as the ship is steaming towards Kuwait, U.S. Antietam, as Antietam, was off the coast of Bahrain. You've heard of that, Bahrain, in the Persian Gulf.
In war maneuvers.
Yeah.
War maneuvers.
Yep. The ship going to assist the Iraqis. And it was off the coast of Bahrain. And it was 2:30 in the afternoon. I was told that Danny was up on deck and he had just finished an ice cream cone. And all of a sudden there was this warning that there was a ship's fire in the engine room. And so Danny, sometimes he got in trouble, but he always wanted to help people. And sometimes it did cause him trouble, but he always the first to help the person. Well, when he heard that, the alarm went off, of course, the ship's fire in the engine room. So come to find out, he was the first one to run down to the engine room, and a couple of his friends, I guess, were behind him. And I guess what he looked at was fire behind this panel. And I don't know why in God's name he did, but he was trying to help. He opened the door of this panel. And his last words were, "I know." He looked at it and he said, "Holy shit." And when he did, the waves from the ocean rocked the boat. And when the boat rocked, it sent the panel right at Danny, that it was alive, the panel was alive. And it hit him. It was amazing. It just made a tiny mark in his elbow. And I think he went flying under something. Well, and his three supervisors came down, and they tried to revive Danny for an hour and a half, but they couldn't bring him back. It was so powerful, this electricity, and it brought him right into cardiac arrest, and they tried over an hour and a half to still bring him back. And come to find out, I only found out not that long ago, that back in 1990, They didn't have defibrillators on the ship. And we lost him. And his friend, Kevin Simon, wrote to us. And, Elaine has talked to him several times, and it really affected his life very much. And even to this day, it's not good for him. And after we lost Diane, they helicoptered him off the ship and took him someplace. I don't know exactly where, but then I forget the name. But then, of course, Navy protocol, the Navy, when you're one of us, they own you. And we waited for Ron, the time of his death on the 21st and the Neil men's visit. We waited from August 21st to August 26th on a Sunday morning. No, it was a... Yeah. And we were notified that his body was coming in to Logan Airport on the 26th. So as a family, and the Navy chaplain and the other naval man that was at the house that takes care of bereaved parents were there. So the two of them and our family, myself, my husband and the children, the limousine came for us and drove us to Logan Airport. And when they drove us to Logan Airport, they drove the limousine into a hangar where we were sitting there in the limousine just facing a blank wall so we wouldn't see what was going on behind us. And what was going on behind us was a big jet with his flag draped coffin, and Navy men on both sides. Of course, you've seen the pictures in the lifetime, taking his body off the plane. So by the time they told us to get out of the limousine, we could see this picture in front of our eyes. So they instructed us to walk over near my boy's casket. And this was all done in silence, not a sound. And we just stood there, and the wind was just blowing us. And my daughter, Alicia, didn't even look. She just turned around and had her head here. And we were all lined up as a family. And that's what we were looking at. And we watched them in silence take his body from the plane to the waiting hearse. It was a killer. We followed the hearse to the funeral home in Wakefield. We brought him home to the funeral home in Wakefield Square. And we saw the hearse go up to the funeral home. And then we continued on home in the limousine. Took us home. Well, since he died in August 21st, the news broke to the media. Nightmare week, waiting for his body to come home. The media all over it. come into the house, the newspapers. One paper is so terrible. Boston newspaper is the picture, full length of my poor dear husband. The picture of grief. I wouldn't even want to show you the picture. We were all over the papers. We were on local television. We were even on national television. And it's an awful thing to see television at night. And of course, we wanted to see the news. And my husband and I, at night, as the two of us, we saw our son's naval picture on the television. Now, that's pretty devastating. You can't believe you're looking at your own son on television. And then starting to say what they said. And as it turned out, he was the second casualty in the Persian Gulf. The first casualty, someone was run over by a jeep. It was... a young child. And they brought his body into the First Baptist Church and the flowers. And it was a very silent service because none of us, Danny's siblings, they couldn't even talk. They were so overcome. And then it was just very nice words. And it wasn't long. It didn't last long. And then we all left to go to the graveside. And Danny was buried with the highest
military. We had a choice to have him buried locally, mm-hmm. in the veterans
forest
part of the cemetery, mm-hmm. or to go to
Arlington National,
and we chose local.
We chose local because if he were buried at Arlington National Cemetery in Washington, I wouldn't be able to get out there too far. And I had younger family. And my husband and I, we discussed it, and we said, no, he was born and brought up in Wakefield, and we are going to lay him to rest in Wakefield at the forest glade nearby our home. And so we buried him with a full national,
full military honors.
Yeah.
Yep, the whole process was with full military honors.
And then, after a few months, there were so many questions. And we got the final report from the U.S. Navy admitting and saying that they were responsible for his death. Because these three officers that were in charge of him and others, they charged them all with negligible supervision. He was a killer.
Hmm.
Yeah. And the Navy, Danny's friend was right there when it all happened. He saw it all happened. And I don't know, to this day I think a lot of cover-ups went on because the Navy wrote down what happened of that fateful day, and Kevin Simon, his friend, he wanted him to sign. He says, I'm not going to sign that. He says, that's not what happened. And he was telling all this to Elaine, Aunt Elaine. And so many questions. And also they forbid any of the men on the ship after Danny's death to write to us. And if they had written to us, they'd have been probably kicked out of the Navy or in deep trouble. Big cover up. And Kevin Simon, not long ago, a couple of years ago, or a year ago, after Danny was passing, the ship, of course, continued on to Korea, Singapore, Hong Kong, and at the end of their tour, they made up this yearbook of their trip for the 6 months. No, it's going to last 7 months. And Kevin sent it to Elaine. And I saw it too, the yearbook, and there were all the pictures of the men and where they had gone. And Danny must have had a book too, but they never sent it to us. And they had his picture in it, a small one. And they covered it up, and they said underneath he was from Springfield. So it would throw everybody off, whereby it should have been Wakefield. And then at the end of the book was this big. It was sort of, woof. The last page, this big, was Danny's picture. They dedicated the tour to Danny. And my husband and I, we decided that no matter what we did, we tried different things, but you can't sue the Navy. You cannot sue the government. We found that out. Once your child joins, they own them. So we were very, very bitter, but we found out we couldn't sue the government. And nothing else would bring our boy back. So we laid it to rest. But Danny, this past August, has been gone 26 years. And then this last Saturday, on November 19th, he would have been, if he had lived, he would have been 46 years old. I always, when he was born too, when he grew up 2, 3, 4, I always used to laugh with him and say, Danny, you were my turkey baby. Just before Thanksgiving, he was born, and he'd laugh. He said, Mama, I was your turkey baby. I said, yes. Because I got home the day before Thanksgiving with a new baby. And I wasn't well enough to get any turkey dinner, but I wanted to be home with my family. So I told the doctor, no, I'm going home. And his mother, bless her heart, when I got home that morning, she came down, bless her heart, with 2 roast chickens. She's a great cook. And I said, how am I going to heat these up? And I wasn't feeling good, of course. So I put them in an electric fry pan, these 2 chickens. And so somehow we got through our Thanksgiving. And I was home with my family, and that meant a lot. Yeah. So, that's the story.
That's good. Yeah.
I hope, your visit down here is very depressing, isn't it? Couldn't be helped.
It's okay.
Because that's our story.
Yeah. It's less sad, and it's
and he loved music.
It's better to know.
He loved music, the rock and roll, and all the crazy music he loved.
But it was such a crushing blow, psychologically.
Yeah. No one can imagine.
We have yet to recover from it.
Yeah.
It's our burden.
Yeah, a cross to bear. It's a killer. You never recover. It's like in your heart, but it's always there. Oh, poor Ben. Sorry, Ben.
No.
Do you have any questions now?
I think you covered everything. Yeah.
But I want you to have this.
Okay.
Because this tells more or less what I just told you.
Mm-hmm.
But I want your dad to see it. And you can keep...
I may take a picture of the pictures that you have.
Oh, yeah. Anything. Yeah. And this is when he was... before he died on his ship. Doing so well. he wrote to us and said he was making all his supervisors very happy, remember?
Yes.
And he graduated when he was in California.
They called him a hard charger.
Oh.
He was so aggressive to do everything. And actually, he went up through the ranks very quickly. He got all the way to...
Electrician Mate 3.
Yeah.
And he graduated after the 7-month training in California, before he came home in April. They graduated California. I have his picture. It's of his whole group. And he graduated second in his class. And it was, how many were in that class? Over 100.
It was a biggie. Yeah.
And he was so upset. He said to his father, he says, I would have been number one in the class if it wasn't for one, this one question. Wasn't it? Remember he said that?
Yeah.
Yeah, he was upset. His girlfriend. It was a serious relationship. It was terrible. Yeah. And of course I still have the newspaper clippings, as I told you. And that's your bottle of water, if you'd like a drink.
Oh, okay. Thank you.
This is for you. I'm going to get a chance to make the copies for you and Dad, and I'd like a bag of you.
Okay, yep.
And that's for you. And that says everything, more or less, of what I told you today, wrapped up there.
Except for my dream.
Yeah.
That wasn't in there.
No. I had a dream about him too. He's walking away with Jesus.
That was so realistic that.
If you have doubts.
That dream was so realistic that it's.
Yeah. Oh, so real.
Lodged in my brain.
Yeah. But you know, we were blessed with a big family. We were blessed. We've been blessed with a large family, long life. But Danny's loss was the one major tragedy of our lives, and it never leaves.
It was the reason why I retired early.
Yeah, he had to. He couldn't work.
Just
couldn't concentrate.
Yeah.
Ran out of gas.
Yeah.
I had a senior manager position and a corporate manager position in the company. But
Digital is an engineer. He wiped them out. Me too.
Yep. I was even aimed to potentially become a vice president, but...
It all went out the window. It destroyed us. But thank God we love each other, and we made it through, and we had to stay together and be together in all of this, because sometimes tragedies like this can break up families. And I can see why. Because you go this way and the other one goes that way and grieves, but we were together in all this. So, Do you have any other questions?
No, that's...
Are you sure?
Yeah.
So we just went on.
Yep.
You don't have a choice.
Right.
Yep. You have to keep moving forward.
Have a drink, Ben. You can take that with you. I took it. A year later, the war broke out. After Danny died in August of 1990, and the Persian Gulf, quote, war broke out in January of 1991. Then we bombed the heck out of Saddam in Iraq. Oh, gosh, I lost my train of thought then. I'm sorry, I lost it. Oh, yeah. So in 1991, we were notified... And from, I forget who notified us, someone from the Navy, but this is in June of, well, after the war was over. Started in January. How long did it last, honey? A couple of months?
Persian Gulf War? It was fast. Yeah.
Well, after that, in the spring, I think we were notified by naval people, and this is a year later, and we're trying to hang on, the two of us, and then, oh my God, it was opened all up again, informing us that they were going to honor our son, Daniel, and men from Massachusetts that perished in the Persian Gulf conflict. And they were going to have a memorial service on board the ship, the USS, can you remember this? Because I think I put it in your notes.
Battleship.
On board the battleship, the USS Massachusetts. And this ship was stationed in Fall River, Massachusetts. And that's right close to Rhode Island. Give you a little idea of the location. And they extended an invitation to Grampy and I to go to this memorial service because they were going to honor Daniel. And I said to Grandpa, oh my God, I can't, how can we ever get through it again?
We did do it.
Oh my God, we talked and we did do it and we went.
And there was a plaque, they put a plaque in the ship.
Big plaque down below. Beautiful.
And they had a regular memorial on board the ship.
Oh, God.
And whole nine yards.
Family members were invited to sit on board the top deck.
Yep.
And they had a beautiful memorial service honoring all the Massachusetts men that perished. And they read every single name. This is a year later. Opened it all up again. We had to go through it again. And every name they read off, they ring the bell. And they ring the bell. And you can't imagine after that bell in your head, it's just, you sit there and you just, oh. We were just holding on to ourselves, both of us, as tight as we could.
Yep.
Which we did through everything. We, two of us just hung on to each other as tight as we could. We couldn't let go of each other. But here we had to go through this whole thing on the ship again. Oh, my God. And then it came to Daniel M. Jones.
Bang.
Oh, killer. Then after that, we were invited to go down below, as Grampy said, to see this plaque in their memory on board ship. Oh, it's a beautiful plaque. It's like as big as the whole window frame, from frame to frame, and we went down to look at it, and it said Persian Gulf, and then the names were like this and this, and at the bottom, and oh my God, where they put Daniel's name was right in the middle. You couldn't even miss it. I said, oh my God, look at where they put his name. And they had a bench there where you could sit and just look at it. And oh, what a day. What a killer day. And after we went down and looked at it, and then we went up on deck, and we just stood there, the two of us, arm in arm, after all of it was done, and just looked out at the ocean. We just couldn't believe it all. And so that's another thing we had to go through. And then the coup de grace was the newspaper men were there again. My God. And unbeknownst to us, they took the picture of Grampy and I just hugging and holding on as tight as we could. And my God, wasn't it in the newspaper, the Boston Globe, the next day, right on the front page.
Yep.
My God. And my co-workers, I went to work, and they all get the, back then, you got newspapers. And they couldn't believe it. There was Grampy and I on the front page. And one co-worker said to me, "Oh, Arlene, I'm so sorry." And one man didn't understand. He said, "Oh," he said, "I thought by now that it would be a little easier for you." Easier? I could have just about punched him right in the face.
Yeah.
How cold. And I said, "No, it's not any easier." And I walked away from him. But that's what we had to go through. And then after that, that was the end of it. So if you ever go down to Fall River, Massachusetts someday and go aboard the USS Massachusetts in Fall River, as I repeat, you go down. You have to get a ticket now to go on the ship to tour. You'll see your uncle's name. Yep. And of course, Andy, all of us. And Andrew, oh, they were only 2 years apart because your father's born in 72 and Danny's born in 70. And every morning, I can even see them now, I'd look out the bedroom window because they took the bus, and this is in high school. And every morning, all through high school, Dan graduated in 88, Andy in 90, and every morning they'd wait for each other and they'd walk down the street to go under the bridge to get the bus to go to Wakefield High School. And Danny was always on the outside because he was taller. And the two of them, down they go. Andy always had a lot of books. My Danny? Not a book. No. And they used to yell at him, "Well, why don't you study? And everything comes so easy to you." My Alicia was a year ahead of him in school. He used to help her with her homework, and she'd yell because he'd try to help her. "I don't need any help. Don't you help me, Danny. Get away from me." Remember, she used to yell at him because he's so smart. But he never opened a book. Everything came easy to him in school. Yeah, so your father always had an armful of books because they didn't have backpacks then. And he's loping down because he was 6'4". He had this walk, you know. Not a care in the world. The teachers even told me when I had conferences, he does it on purpose. He just aggravated them because he knew it, and then he just pretended he was dumb. One teacher was so funny in the third grade. Oh, God. Well, as I said, his birthday was in November. And so he got into school like a year earlier. He was always like a year younger than all the rest of the kids, you know, because of his birthday, the way it fell. And he was in the third grade this time. The teacher told me when I went to a conference, she says, "Danny used to get up out of his seat and stand there and just fall over, just to be funny." She says, you know, all different funny things. He was a character. He was just one to entertain people. And, of course, the girls loved him. Very popular. So So that was my Danny. And we did things a lot when they were children. We went everywhere and had good times. Yeah. But he was never interested in sports. He just wanted fun. Just enjoy himself. So now, Ben, do you have any more questions?
No. I'm going to interview my dad next.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. All righty. So...
anything to take notes with?
No.
All right. Mom, you want to close that lounge door? Thank you. No, not if you entertain her in there.
I don't know where I should put this. Maybe if you sit down. Perfect.
It's chilly. Sit like this. Sit back, relaxed.
Or like, you can sit there, I can sit there.
You can sit where?
I'll sit there. I think that'll be fine. Doesn't really, yeah.
Is it recording?
Yeah.
It has been for a while. Oh, okay.
Mm-hmm. So your mom's not going to be part of this?
Yeah. That's not. Do you want mom part of this?
Yeah.
All right. You pause. We'll get mom.
Mom, just for like a few minutes.
Okay.
Oh, you close the door too. You left the bar.
Here's a lie down. That's not how this works. This guy's just gonna go out the back door, so if that happens, we've gotta abort.
Oh, I thought you were gonna be.
Oh. No. Okay.
You can see us right now?
I think I can see you. Yeah. So, do you know what my project is about?
Yes and no.
Okay. So, I'm taking the storytelling class for my FYS, and I have to talk about a childhood memory. Mm-hmm. And then I have to do a project and figure out how much of what I remember is true, and then go into more detail and stuff like that, and just explore. Okay? So, my memory is visiting Uncle Danny's grave.
Mm-hmm.
And I want to know how much of that is real that I remember.
Okay.
So, do you remember that?
Yes, I do.
Mm-hmm.
Uh-huh.
Can you talk about it?
Oh, it was probably pretty while ago when you were... eight? Do you remember how old you were?
No.
A couple times, I'm sure, whenever we went down, right?
Summer day?
Whenever we went to see Lincoln Jams, we did try to go see Uncle Ben. It's great. I know that.
Right. And, I don't have a lot of memory of it, frankly. I just remember the kids being there and pointing out to where Danny's gravestone is.
There's a whole row of veterans. I don't know if you remember that.
Okay.
And then they're all the same stones. And then there's all this little something.
That's right. Yeah. That's right. So the separate veteran section, it's the newer veteran section with a flagpole in the middle. And he is, if you're looking at the flagpole, he is to the left and a little bit forward of the flagpole. And stone, they're all white marble look to them, although his has a little bit of a slate gray color to it. It's a little bit unique. Mm-hmm. And there's often stuff placed around it that, from people who have visited it. And we pointed that out to you and Elizabeth. We were all four of us were there.
Mm-hmm.
And I think the visit was reasonably brief. We drove there, I suspect, from when we were visiting.
Sometimes we'd walk. I know sometimes we did walk.
But, and it was, I think it coincided with a visit with birthday. Uncle Ethan and Aunt Janice.
Yeah.
It was young. But it's been a good number of years.
That's all I need for you.
Come on. That's easy.
Well, I can ask you one question.
Come on.
Oh.
Oh, yeah. Come on back.
What do you think about being made? Well, what do you think this film made?
I think
that's fantastic. I think it's fantastic. I think, and tough issue, but I think it's a tough we actually think talk a lot about. It's and something that we don't talk. It's for me, one of the nicest things I think of what parts of it is the fact that I think now is part about it. We're then digitally archiving in a sense archive Danny's death, his life and his death, and what it means and death. What, you know, Grammy and Grampy are getting older, and they've never sat down at. Sort of talked about it, and some materials have been uncovered as a result of it, and in some respects I think it was probably hard for Grammy and Grampy to talk about it as much as it is for me, but I think in the long run, I think in a way it's therapeutic.
Okay, that's it for you. So, I have a few questions. I can just tell you all the questions at once, and then you can talk about
it. Okay. Sure.
Okay. So, any memories of Uncle Danny?
Mm-hmm.
Anything distinct? Blah, blah. School, home. Do you know what he wanted to do after the war? And then, do you know where you were on the day you heard the news?
Mm-hmm. So, I don't know exactly. I have no memory of what he wanted to do after the war. But he and I were close. He was the fifth child of seven, and he's only about 18 months older than I am. So we were all stacked in pretty close, the first six children. and then there's a little bit of, a little bit more of a gap between child 6 and 7, about 4.5 years, but from 1 through 6, we're all stacked in pretty close, 1.5 years, 2 years, and Dan was my older brother, and interestingly enough, I'll always consider him to be my older brother. He would have been 46 on the 19th of this month, and I'm 44, and even though he died back in 1990, he'll always be my older brother. And with that, because he was my immediate older sibling, we were very close, and we did a lot together. We spent a lot of time together. And that involved typical childhood, playing outside, getting into mischief and trouble, for sure. We did a fair amount of that together. And but he was my older brother. He was always there for me. We were close because, for one, you know, I think in age, but also we had a lot in common. He protected me. I mean, I remember times, and I remember one distinct time in high school where I was getting a little bit bullied, and he took it upon himself. He knew that, and he took it upon himself to talk to a few people involved, and the bullying ended. And I think it's important that we stick up for ourselves during situations growing up, but it's also really important to have someone that looks after you. Oh. And it's nice to have a big brother that keeps an eye on you and takes care of you, just as it would be a big brother to a younger sister, or an older sister to a younger sister. But so we had that big brother, little brother relationship, and we did a lot together. Then he joined the Navy, and which I think was really good for him because it offered, gave him a job, gave him some training, gave him a little direction into perhaps what he may not want to do in life. He grounded him a little bit. He was a great, was a big free spirit. That he loved the Grateful Dead. He was a deadhead when he went on concert, traveled and social to multiple concerts, and he was a big spirit, verse in your heart. He was all really, he was a good friend to a lot of people. Really loved and loved, and he just really loved life and loved people. And so he was, went to train, and he was training, and then went to Naval State, California, permanent naval electrician, maybe. And it was an August mate, the name, and then in August 2nd of 90, Iraq, 19, the day I recorded basic training, I mean, went to bid for the Army. I went to Fort Knox, Kentucky, and was going to be there for Kentucky about 2 months, and be there, and then I would have been heading to Fort Rock with a family for going on helicopter to, but well, I had been training at Fort Knox for not 2.5 weeks, from the week, and it was hot. There was a hot day, and the company formed in front of the company headquarters. There were several platoons, and I was requested. They were looking for someone who was handy with woodwork. Found it very odd, and so they called my name out of the platoon. And when you entered the military, then you, back then you, when you enlisted, you listed some of your hobbies and interests, and they knew some of your, they knew what your hobbies and interests were when you entered the service. So they must have seen that I had listed as one of my interests was woodworking. And it was really more of an excuse to sort of pull me out of the platoon without sort of making some dramatic scene. But I found it unusual, but back then, you know, when you're private and basic training, you did what they told you to do. And so I was pulled out of the platoon and I was pulled into the headquarters building by my drill sergeant, and we were taken and we traveled to a room, and when we entered the room there were several additional people to include the company commander, the officer, the company commander. My drill sergeant was with me. There was an army chaplain and a couple other folks. I don't recall who what they did, but they sat me down on a couch similar to this, and they said, "We have a phone call for you, and it's your sister Elaine." And I said, "Okay." And finding it very unusual, and I was quite nervous at that point. I didn't know. I was young. I was 18 years old. I really didn't have any idea what was going on. And picked up the phone, and sure enough, it was Adelaine, and she said, "Danny died." And I don't remember a specific description as to how he died. I don't remember specifically what she told me in terms of how he died. It's just that he died over in the Persian Gulf. As we know, he was the second casualty over there. A second casualty tied to the Desert Storm, Desert Shield. And it was a non-combat death, accidental death. And he died aboard his ship. And I remember just crying. And very difficult to make sense of it all, particularly when you're only 18 and you're not home, you're being told this information in a foreign place, you know, in a foreign building with foreign people, and no one really there no loved ones there to comfort you. The only person to comfort you is yourself. And you, of course, the chaplain was there offering what he knows to comfort people during those times, and the other individuals there, but no loved ones. And that was hard. Then I was put right back into the platoon after a period of time in this room. And I was told that within so many days, that I would be sent home for the wake and for the funeral. And for the training room, I had to do training, go back to training, basic training. So it was intense training. Imagine the sergeants yelling, "Jim, dirty, getting up and, you know, all dark there, and training the old, but the dark and night." They had this entire training assembled, the entire division, some company division, or training the multiple battalion companies on training in this parking lot on and large. They had the Italian commander was there, and he at least spoke under Danny and the dead briefly, and they played Tavis death then, and it was pretty hard. And then they relieved everyone for the night, and really, so then within short order I was fitted with dress A uniform, class B uniforms, dress uniform, and taken to the airport, and I flew home. And I was home for 4 days. I attended the wake, attended the funeral, and then flown back to Fort Knox, Kentucky, where I had to then resume the majority of my training. And so it was really hard to describe because Danny's death didn't really sink in until I got older, much older, frankly. And back then, I was just so young, it was just really hard to comprehend it, and it just didn't quite seem real and impossible. I mean, even at the wake, seeing him, he had an open casket at the wake. There he was in his Navy dress uniform, and just very, very difficult to describe. Going back to basic training was probably the best thing, ultimately. It was difficult after 4 days to then leave the comfort of my family and home, but to then go back to and to go back to basic training was quite difficult, but ultimately it was one of the best things, because for the remainder of basic training and then follow-on training, skill training, I was very busy, constantly busy, and so your mind is engaged and you're learning and you're meeting new people, and so it was really good preoccupant to the alternative, which was to reflect that your brother died. And yeah, so then time just seemed to move on, and went to college, and but I think as I get older, or as I got older, like I said, think more of it, you think more of about what his life could have been, or what, you know, if he had even alive, how he lived.
Well, that's all my questions.
Okay. That's it.
Well, that's good.
Alright. Very good.
All right, piece it all together.
Thank you, Matt.
Hopefully it was recording.
Oh, yeah.
That would be good.
Let's see. Yeah, okay, good.